So alternative data is everything that an investor uses which is not traditional data, essentially. So all of the things which traditionally has been used over many decades and beyond of financial data which is produced by companies or produced by governments or kind of official data, that's all traditional data. And alternative data is everything else. And that's a massively expanding tail, like long tail of possibilities. So that includes credit card transaction data, but also it could be geolocation data from a mobile phone, or it could be satellite data, or it could be audio data or ship tracking data, or just a myriad of different and growing types of data which are coming onto the market and which investors can use to make money in the market.
Fascinating. And what is the scope of the Alternative Data Podcast?
So the Alternative Data Podcast, So the Alternative Data Podcast has been going since November 2020. And I've now done, I think, 92 episodes. When it began, I saw a market opportunity for alternative data providers to be better understood and for more people to know what they offer and what can be done with their data. But since then, I've kind of expanded and just chased alternative data in all its directions. So I've had alternative data buyers, like familiar hedge funds like Man Group and Balyasny Asset Management. And I've gone into the corporate side, and I've had McKinsey talking about how their corporate clients are using alternative data. I've gone into government, so I've had the UK Office of National Statistics on board talking about how they're using alternative data to predict GDP or to calculate GDP. Mm-hmm. And I've had the Central Bank of Canada, and most recently I had the SEC on to talk about regulating alternative data. So I'm really trying to map alternative data and the whole world and everything in it. Well, with everything going on now in the world, I mean, the traditional alternative data sets which have long dominated the space are the credit card transaction data sets, as I mentioned. More recently, there have been technological innovations such as, so NLP, natural language processing, has long been useful in alternative data for extracting sentiment from text. So companies have used it to understand, in an earnings call, hedge funds have discovered that if the earnings call contains too many uses of the word but, then it's a negative, you know, and so they can trade off that. But more recently, I had a company on the podcast who was doing audio NLP. So they were understanding, it's a company called Helios Life, and they were understanding the tone of somebody perhaps on an earnings call. And they were seeing that Elon Musk is talking in a certain way, but he had suppressed excitement in his voice. So the suggestion was that there was something he knew that the markets didn't. And so if you bought on that suppressed excitement, you could win. But then it's not all, so the podcast is literally just trying to map the market. It's not all the novelist data sets that are interesting. I've had my first patent data set on recently. And patent data sets are wonderfully steady in terms of it. They are produced by experts, government regulated experts around the world. You get 200 years of history, which quantitative investors love. You know, you can go all the way back. So it's incredibly granular data and very valuable. And then obviously more recently, I have been dipping my toe in the crypto world, and I had a company called Sentiment with an A, based out of Switzerland, who are creating alternative data for the crypto space. So understanding, so looking into the blockchain or understanding sentiment around specific crypto currencies or that kind of thing. So it's a vastly growing space. No one person can keep up with everything that's going on. It's very, very exciting. So alternative data has come very much from the kind of sophisticated end of the hedge fund space, because you needed to be a sophisticated hedge fund to be able to create the data science team and to actually afford to build it all yourself, essentially, and then claim all the profits for yourself as well. So it's all very deeply secret for a lot of its history. But that's changing increasing as the market matures, then more tools come to the market. Mm-hmm. My company, Exabel, actually is a alternative data platform, which makes it easy for a wider selection of investors to use alternative data. And so that kind of development unlocks a longer tail of long-only investors, for example, who previously thought alternative data was was outside their scope. But there's a lot of buzz as well outside the financial world and in the corporate space as well. Increasingly, corporates can use, they call it external data on the corporate side, but they can use it to understand their competition. They can use the data to understand what's going on with their supply chain. I mean, ESG obviously has been on a phrase on everyone's lips, and alternative data allows you to actually build very strong, powerful ESG measurements, like from the bottom up. So there's various directions of expansion, but I would say corporate is the space that everyone's excited about in alternative data as a whole. Before creating the alternative data podcast, in my previous life, I was a geopolitics analyst for a company called Stratfor. So my previous life was geopolitics, and I'm very excited about the opportunity to use data to answer geopolitical questions. Had we been able to foresee with certainty that Russia was about to invade Ukraine, then bought nickel just before, then investors could have been very happy. The problem is the world is an extremely complex system, and so I'm not sure it's been nailed yet that I'm aware of. Mm-hmm. But there is increasing the chipping away is happening at the cliff face, and there are data providers which will allow you to scrape all the sentiment of what people are saying in Russia, for example, about what's going on in Ukraine. There are data providers which will allow you to analyze the battlefield to a very deep extent, so you can try and predict what tomorrow's news will be and in terms of the battlefield. There are data providers which can provide extremely good polling information and analysis. So it is chipping away, and I do believe that there will be a quantitative solution to geopolitical questions. It's just to try and get a kind of holistic answer to the theory of everything is it will be a challenge, but I think it's an exciting challenge, and I think data will be the way to make these kind of predictions in the future. I think alternative data is just the future of data, essentially. As the history of the markets has shown, every time you get a new technological advancement, then essentially it ultimately ends up getting folded into the system, and everyone just relies upon it. And we're already seeing it as alternative data spreads. And in some sectors, just from a purely investment perspective, then they say you can't trade Chipotle without using alternative data, because it's so saturated, really, the use of it. And I expect that to grow from an investment perspective. But then, I mean, there are a lot of interesting conversations going on at the moment around financial, like monetizing alternative data as well. And potentially we have a world where the alternative data and data in general is a little bit siloed and is paid in kind of batches of money, paying for batches of data. Potentially we could have more of a flow, and potentially we could end up seeing alternative data payment coming back to you and me, who are the ones who generated it in the first place, as kind of people using our credit cards or something like that. So I think there's a lot of technological innovation going on in this space. I think it essentially, what is the future of alternative data? It's the future of the world. I think it's already happening. I think this is already the case. But to be honest, I'm not a crypto specialist. I've just dabbled in crypto. I've done two episodes around the crypto space. So I wouldn't feel confident drawing great inferences about the future direction of it. But what I just described, which was the money flowing one way and the data flowing the other in a much more kind of organic and flowing way, that could potentially be a problem which could be solved by the blockchain. So this is potentially where the two worlds could meet in the future.